daily, new innovations are coming. How to assist the planet, how to use new energy forms, new innovations in business. The old dense structures are not working. In this time, what you will see is a global economic structure that works for the entire world, not the few. There is that which would be the United Nations. It will be similar, but much more powerful and collaborative than it's ever been, because you're a collaborative species. And in this collaboration, you're better together than you are apart. Yes, there will be countries, but not at odds with each other, because you have the same purpose, not to rule the world, but to expand the world in awareness, innovation, and maintaining the sustainability of the planet itself and life itself. So this is where you are going.
Sheila Gillette, THEO Group, welcome on the show. What are you most excited about right now in your life?
What I'm excited about is a new program we're bringing out, and also one we're starting in January that changes people's lives. You know, I've been doing 5 decades in this work, and it's always my intention to make any situation better when I leave than when I first got there. So hopefully that happens in our discussion, but also in every mentoring program that we do. It's to enrich people's lives and to expand them as the spiritual being that they are, to recognize how truly powerful each and every one of us is.
Mm. Sheila, you've lived an extraordinary life. You began very early, in your late teens, early 20s, and you became a very early mother at that time. Mm-hmm. When you were going through the pregnancy of one of your daughters, 1969 was a pivotal year for you because you went through this near-death experience. And in that near-death experience, it was almost like you called out to God saying, "Give me a job, I'll do whatever you want." And something very interesting got activated right after that. Some psychic abilities started popping off. Tell us about that experience of getting activated after crossing over to the other realm, bringing back maybe some capacities that you didn't know you had beforehand. What happened in that year?
Well, in that year, to your point, I had a near-death experience. I had pulmonary embolus after the birth of my second daughter. And I was in intensive care and I had a miraculous healing. I saw the bright light come. To your point, I was saying, "Hey, God, give me a job. I will do anything," because I had 2 little kids at home and I had a brand new baby. And to your point, I was a very young teenage mother when my first daughter and my son were born. And then I was in my 20s when my second daughter was born. And my lungs were non-functional. I felt as if I had an elephant sitting on my chest, because pulmonary embolus breaks the blood vessels in your lungs. So they fill with fluid and you can't breathe. And that's what was happening to me. So I just knew if I closed my eyes, I'd never open them again. And so I just kind of kept saying that as like a mantra. And then the room, the little cubicle in intensive care, became extremely bright. And when I noticed a movement at the end of my bed, Jesus was standing there. And of course, you can imagine, I went, "Whoa, this is incredible." And I was mesmerized by his eyes and this energy that was emanating from him that I'll call love. It was just this calming presence. And he took his arms and he crossed them like this. And when he did so, he smiled at me. And I heard in my inner mind hearing, like we hear our own thoughts, a distinct male voice say, "Remember, my child, you're loved." And at that point, I felt as the top of my head opened up and this warm liquid was poured in. And as it seeped down through every cell in my body. Now, remember, my lungs weren't working. So this heaviness that I felt like the elephant, it went away. It just went through my whole body. And it was probably just a few seconds, but I'm as clear about it today. And that was 54 years ago. I was as clear about it today as I am, as I was when it happened. And then I started getting better. The doctors at that point when I had this experience were being prepared for my death. They were telling...
Why do you believe you saw Jesus at that moment?
I always felt Jesus was my friend. You know, everybody puts a deity, you know, and it depends on what your affiliations might be or your spiritual connections might be. You know, that's not unusual in a near-death experience to see a master in to whatever your experience is. But it was unexpected, for sure. And when I heard his voice, because it was a male voice, not my own thoughts, like we hear our own speak, it was a distinct male voice that said, "Remember, my child, you are loved." And then I got better. I started getting better. And when I got out of the hospital, I had all kinds of psychic phenomena happening to me, internally, externally. I could hear messages, like I heard Jesus's voice that day. And messages about the world and messages about people that I could not have known any idea. And then it just progressed. I could do automatic writing. I could do many what you call.
You were moving objects as well. Yeah, tell us more about that.
Yeah, I sat there and I thought, well, this is interesting. And I would just concentrate. Now, I don't know if my mind energy was moving them or spirit was, but I would look at something on the table, you know, a figurine or a salt shaker or whatever it might be that was sitting there, and I just concentrate on it and it would move. So that was pretty, I had lots of phenomena. It was pretty exciting.
But how would you differentiate the mind energy and the spirit now?
Well, see, I know. See, our soul is so much bigger than our body. And it's eternal. We just get in these bodies and they're a gift because they let us navigate this beautiful planet. It also has the sensory perceptivities that we have, you know, touch, smell, hear, all of those kinds of things. But in my travels over these years, I've come to know mentalists and people that do bend. It's called warm forming metal, and I've done it myself, bending spoons and forks. I don't know if you've heard of that.
I've seen that
in my closet over there that I've kept because it's so interesting. But that's part of it.
We had Dr. Dean Radin come on the show, and he showed us one of his spoons that he bent with his mind, and you know, he was testing the telekinesis as well.
Yeah. So I, you know, we have the power. We really have so much more power than we give ourselves credit for. So I, you know, like I said, I was doing all these personal experiments because I didn't know anybody doing this back then. I didn't talk about it to people because people were afraid of these types of things. Not like today, where you see it on television, you hear it, even news anchors say, "Oh, I was channeling so and so." I mean, it's a common lexicon in our language that wasn't. You know, I didn't go into social situations and say, "Well, guess what I can do? You know, if it, people would have gone, oh, I'm really afraid of that.
Little party trick.
Yeah, exactly. But it progressed. I had all this phenomena. I had clairaudience, which is that inner mind hearing that we all are capable of. You know, we hear our higher selves speak to us all the time. But then I could do automatic writing, just hold a pen and messages would be given. And then I trance spontaneously and became a direct voice trance channel. Channeling wasn't even a word in this genre at that point. And the energy of the angels came in, took over my vocal cords and began to speak directly through me. So it's been quite a journey, let's put it that way, but a good one. A good one.
Yeah. Now, the group or the entity, the archangels that you channel, THEO, they didn't come in at first. There was a being called Orlos that had to attune your energy to be able to, what he says, receive the wisdom of the higher teachers or higher masters. I would love to know this process of energetic attunement, what it was like, because a lot of people, I think now with the new consciousness, are activating in the same way as you are, maybe some spontaneously, some through intense intention and repetition. So what is the energetic attunement that people have to go through in order to be able to hold energies that are coming from other dimensions, energies that are coming through when you're channeling?
Everything is energy, vibrational frequency. Our soul is. Our soul frequency stays the same. What changes is what's going on in this physical body and in our cellular structure. So I can liken it to electricity. Really, it goes through your nervous system is your electrical body. And so the nervous system has to be able to accommodate these higher frequencies of the angels and the guides. So Orlos was assisting, as well as teaching, but assisting my body to be able to receive that kind of, let's say it's kind of like I was at 110 outlet and they upped it to 220 or whatever. But it,
The voltage, they had to up the voltage.
It's just like here in the United States, when we travel to Europe, around the world, we have to have adapters to the electrical sockets because they're not the same in the United States as they are internationally. So it's kind of like I had to adapt to this energy coming in, which was quite strong and powerful. And so that took a couple of years for my body to be connected. And you probably will understand this because, you know, computers weren't available to me when I was your age. This is something recent, but you all have grown up with them. But it's kind of like my daughter, who is our technology person in our company. She was explaining to me as she was building me a computer in my living room one day for Mother's Day. She says, well, Mom, these circuits have to come in. They have to shake hands and connect. And that's how email does. It has to go through the air and it has to connect and shake hands. So she gave me a real visual that I'm sharing now in this process because we have an understanding of that. That's what happens when THEO comes in. They come in and they connect to the cells that create an opportunity for them to take over my vocal cords and to speak directly. That's the best way I can describe it. It made sense to me because we have those kinds of systems in our bodies.
And now this teaching of asking and therefore it is given to you really clicked for you when you asked God during your near-death experience, give me a job. Now, this is a job that you could have not seen anywhere else because it was literally one of the first, let's say you were a way shower for this capacity for this information to flow through in human beings, at least in modern times of what we know. I believe that ancient humans have been probably channeling as well for many, many centuries and decades. I'd love to know, because when Orlos came through, this being that was preparing you, you had the free will to opt out. You had the free will to say, no, 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 this is way too much for you. Mm-hmm. Why did you keep going?
When you make a commitment to God to live, to stay in your body, you don't say no. That's what's kept me going all this time, is I'm here. I've been able to raise my children. I've been able to have grandchildren. I've been able to live a beautiful life because of that commitment, because I was healed. I had a miraculous healing. I truly believe that Jesus healed my body that day.
Huh, that's beautiful. I have a funny question for you. Your current partner, Marcus, who you guys have been really side by side in this mission, just getting this information of THEO out to the world. You've said that Marcus never runs out of questions. And he said that you're only limited by your curiosity and imagination, the questions that you have. So I find it really interesting, and I want to know, what, in your perspective, what is the best question that Marcus has asked THEO, and what is the response that they gave?
Oh my gosh. You know, this is 26 years worth. So you're asking me to find
it. Maybe the recent 2-3 years, we'll put a boundary on it.
You know, he's always curious about, you know, our souls and our advancement and the expansion of that. He's very curious about like out of body experiences and what happens there. And he always asks about our continuing advancing our consciousness, our awareness. You know, he doesn't run out of questions, because as you know, once a question is answered, then that can bring on 10 more, because our mind starts going, okay, I can accept that concept, but what if? And so there's this continual curiosity that happens. And we're living in a time of shifting the consciousness of humanity. You know, we're all way showers of that in our own way of expanding and showing others the way. You know, just because we're collaborative species. You know, most of us have been taught we're competitive, but humans are animals, and we're herd animals, and we're better together than we are apart. That's how good collaboration, good innovation happens, because one person can't think of all the questions, and one person can't have all the answers. I mean, when we come together in a mastermind, that's what that's about, is that everybody brings their genius and shares that what they know and their ideas and thoughts. And that's where our species is going, even though it doesn't look like it today, but it is.
Yeah. And a modern teacher, he's Tony Robbins, he said that your life is determined by the quality of your questions. And that's also a big pattern that I've seen in wisdom seekers, is that they're always finding ways to improve their questioning, improve the way that they can ask, not even outside of them, but inside of them, because we can also ask questions to our soul. I know THEO said that when you are sick, or if you are attaching to someone's emotions, you can ask yourself, whose is this? Because maybe some of that emotion is not yours. You're just, you know, absorbing it from the people around you. So you can ask yourself. Sheila, I had a funny story for you and maybe for our audience of how I sort of came across your material. A lot of synchronicities along the way, but we were in an interview with my good friend Elizabeth April, and during the interview, she channeled a past life of mine when I was a being living on Atlantis, ancient Atlantis. And she even channeled a name for that aspect of me, and the name that she channeled was THEO. And she said that this is the higher aspect of you that you can always question and you can always go to when you need it. For people that want to tune into that, they can go to that conversation as well. But immediately I started looking up THEO on the internet, and just Sheila Gillette, you started coming up. And then you came up again when I started reading Esther Hicks' books and Abraham Hicks. She mentions that you were one of her first mentors. So I was like, I need to know this woman. I need to talk to this woman. Like, there's too many synchronicities in the way. But going off that, since I looked up THEO on Google and found you, what did you find when you looked up THEO?
Well, we didn't have Google then. So I looked it up in the dictionary because that's what they told me to do. And THEO is the beginning or God. So if you know, in the Christian symbol, the fish, the ichthys, and there are those Greek symbols in it. In the center symbol is a circle with an H in it. And that's the symbol for THEO or God.
Wow. H. So
yeah, and our logo for our company is, because our company is called the THEO Group, is a stylized H, which is for that THEO symbol, but it's also the Pisces symbol, which is for Marcus and I are both Pisces. So, and I created that logo, 45 years ago. But it really stemmed from that original Greek symbol.
So Robert Edward Grant, he was explaining that he got the chance to look behind the painting of Mona Lisa by Leonardo da Vinci. And when you look at the back of Mona Lisa, there are two H symbols clearly drawn out. And this might give you chills, because when you decipher that H, what you take is there's a T in it and there's an H, and that is deciphering the code of Thoth or Thoth, which is this amazing magical being that he said that he was responsible. He was one of the builders of the pyramids, one of the starters of civilization. In other terms, he's been called Hermes. Like, this is all connecting in some way. And maybe we'll even get the chance with THEO to unravel what this H truly means and all of these questions that we're having right now. and I guess with that said, did that resonate with you?
Yeah. You know, we have all kinds of symbols through history. And if you go to Egypt, which they call that the seat of civilization, and they're still excavating and finding more artifacts. In fact, they found another pyramid recently. And so when you're there, you see all this excavation, but there are symbols everywhere. And Da Vinci, in everything that he did, he used the sacred geometry and this symbolism, kind of as a treasure hunt, I think, sometimes. And I loved the books, like the Da Vinci Code and all of those, because they were, they're so much fun to read, but in those are truths. You know, in any fiction, there's a line of truth in any fiction. So if you enjoy them, I think they're a great read, but you can kind of read between the lines of the writer who's researched it. So to your point, there's been so much research done. I think it's very interesting. You know, all the way along, we've been given hints. And what THEO says, you know, the earth is only one choice of experience for a soul. And the soul has billions of choices. But we keep coming back here because it's a great planet to experience. And these bodies are great. Our Earth suits are fascinating. And they our bodies unravel and reveal to us so much of what you're talking about in the sense of psychic ability. That's our God-given right, by the way. Mm. We learn from our body because we're sentient. We feel. This is our receiver right here. You know, like music and television, everything has a receiver for the vibrational frequencies. Well, this is our receiver. But the gift it gives us is the ability to know that and use all those senses. So it's... we could go on for hours. I know we could because
we can.
It's so fascinating, isn't it? It's just such a fascinating thing to discover really how unique and powerful each and every one of us is. We all bring something to this party, every single one of us. No one's better than the other. We all are unique in our own expression of what our creative energy to do. THEO says, people say, what's my purpose? Your purpose is life. You won the lottery. You got a body. And life itself living through you and for you is your soul energy having this earth suit. But what most people want to know is how to express that life energy in what form. And that's our passion. You know, serving others with THEO's wisdom is my passion and my job, if you would. We all have one where we express, and maybe it's similar to somebody else, but we have a unique piece in that. You know, THEO says it would be a really boring world if we had one painting, one book, one song, you know, one sculpture. I mean, the texture of our lives are because we've all come and said yes to sharing our energy on this planet.
Mm. Well, Sheila, with that said, beautiful, beautiful reflection. I would love to know if THEO would be comfortable to drop some wisdom onto us right now. And we'll continue our conversation a little bit later.
Okay. Well, THEO would love to drop some wisdom on you, I'm sure. So it takes just a second for me. I just kind of take a couple of deep breaths that lets me move over and invite THEO in. So here we go.
Here you go.
It is the beginning, is it not?
It is.
We are appreciative of the opportunity to serve. You may ask.
THEO, thank you so much. It's an honor. I would love to have a brief overview of this fifth dimensionary energy that humanity is headed into, or we're already at, and how we can begin to start anchoring more of that in our daily lives going forward.
It's permeating your atmosphere. There are 12 dimensions about the earth. You're experiencing the fifth, which is the thinning veils between your multidimensionality. And what that means is a higher conscious state, relinquishing and releasing old beliefs that have been passed along generationally for thousands of years that do not work anymore. Building new foundational structures, new foundations, opening the mind more, laying new neural pathways in the mind for greater receptivity and understanding and consciousness. So this is the time you've chosen to be incarnate for. The third dimension is your physical reality, your earth suit, the physical structures in which you either live or sit, or walk upon. The fourth has been a spiritual awakening, and fully in the fifth is a realization of consciousness that you're more than your physical structure, that you have more power than you think you do. The sixth will be experienced in your human knowledge and body, and all other are etheric, in which you are in touch with, but will be conscious of, in the usage of that universal field of energy to manifest.
How do you see, from your perspective, the first and second dimension, and then the seventh to the 12th, the ones that we've covered, the ones that we haven't covered?
The first and second was the preparation of this physicality, the material, and some call them densities. So the first and second were very dense energy, in which the earth was formed, in which the bodies became energy within that creating structure. The third is full structure. The chair on which you sit was not a chair until it was thought into being and then created, yes? And so thoughts are things, words are things. They have frequency and vibration of energy that it creates. The fourth is spiritual awakening and knowing that your human soul that gives your body life is larger than your body itself and more powerful. Know this, that your soul gives your brain consciousness. It's not the other way around. That is why the body can, with medical, it has with medical inventions and they continue to be expanded innovatively, can keep a body alive, can keep the body alive, keep the blood pumping, all of those things, cannot keep the brain alive. However, that is why the medical professionals, you call doctors, they will pronounce a human dead when there's no brain functionality. That's because the soul has left the body.
Now, where does that soul then go? I know you said it has a moment of evaluation, where it goes some sort of, a lot of near-death experiencers call a life review. What happens after the physical body?
The physical body is just what is, as we said, the earth suit, your ability to navigate this planet. The soul is eternal, as we said, and we call it birth to birth, not birth death. You birth into the body and you birth again into your multidimensionality, which is energy that is eternal. And the assessment is, how much have you learned? What are you carrying forward? What more do you want to learn in the earth experience? And the learning is emotions.
What can we know from your perspective about emotions specifically? Because I feel that a lot of us in this density are overwhelmed by emotions at times. And you're also saying that we're going through an evolution of also higher intelligence, which allows us to better balance emotions. So first, how do you see emotions? And also, where are we headed in terms of the evolution of mastering our emotions?
Emotions are the experience. It's not to be feared. Most of you ignore or take for granted good emotions. Yes, you just assume them. What you pay attention to are the ones that make you uncomfortable. But they're all important. And so most humans try to avoid feeling uncomfortable. Yes? But those emotions are very rich in telling you something about you. And this is how the consciousness shifts. It is to be friendly to the emotions, because what is running your brain or your human experience is your emotional body. It's the first reactor to any stimulus, situation, condition, challenge. You react from your emotional body, not your intellect. Mm. What we call this is the little aspects or fragments of your soul that have been frozen in time through circumstance, situation, or condition in which a belief about you that's untrue was adopted or created, meaning not being worthy, lovable, not enough. That comes from the outside to the inner. And so those emotional responders we call triggers in certain stimulus where one feels emotionally triggered, highly sensitized to, uncomfortable from, yes? And how you change these beliefs about self are asking who inside is uncomfortable, which means what part of self is stuck and at what age. And the adult self loves that part of self, for love changes everything. It's a broader conversation, of course, but if you think about emotions like the rainbow, you wouldn't take any of the colors out, would you? No. So don't take any of the emotions out of your emotional spectrum. They don't have to be destructive, the uncomfortable ones. However, when repressed, can create havoc in the physicality.
Yes, yes. We've also, when talking about the creation of how reality is manifested, we've heard many times from other teachers of focusing on these elevated emotions that we're talking about, love, gratitude, grace, joy. What would you say upon that, of that paradigm of just focusing on the elevated emotions? I know you said we have to look at the whole rainbow, but if we get to grasp more of the bliss, more of the good emotions, what changes in our life then and as a collective?
What changes is emotional maturity and your ability to manifest the things that you want, because you know you're worthy of them. You love yourself enough to know that you are a divine being having a human experience and you deserve the life you wish to live. But many have spoken only think the good thoughts. Yes? Good thoughts are excellent. But most of you think about what if something horrible is going to happen, do you not? So we encourage a flipping of those statements to what if something good is going to happen. Fear and faith ask the same of you, to believe in something that is unseen yet. And you're master creators, so make it up good. Yes, create it good and know that you're worthy. How do you know that? Is because you reframe the beliefs that were created in that moment of stress or abuse or lack of love, we would say. And the adult you can reframe, reparent that part of self with love, bringing it forward and releasing those beliefs, rewriting the script. And it's not through arrogance or narcissism, because some would say that those are personality disorders. It's through truth. And that full love brings forward those aspects that believe you're not worthy and are loved into the present. And there's a full recognition of that soul power in you as this is done. And you lay new neural pathways in your brain from the default system of fright, flight, fear into this new paradigm or consciousness that's evolving in you.
Mm. And when talking about densities for just a moment, I wanted to know what happens, because when it comes to densities, it almost seems like we are going to a new dimension. And other guides have also talked about that matter and physicality can also change while our perception of reality changes. So does matter actually become more fluid and malleable as we ascend in consciousness? And then are we able then to create more of the reality that we desire?
Yes, simply said. That's laying new neural pathways, isn't it? If you are not feeding the old belief systems, the old patterns, and you're feeding with your thoughts the new, the what if something good is going to happen, because life is happening through you and for you, not to you, because you're the creator, and life always wants more life lived through you. So as you change your minds, as you change those beliefs, you change your neural pathways, your minds, into a new belief system that is more creative and not destructive, we would say it this way, because that's old way of being that doesn't work. And in that, there's more creativity, there's more recognition of each and every one of you contributes to the greater good and whole of this planet in a way that is expansive, not contractive.
There has also been a lot of what we call lost civilizations, like Atlantis, like Mu, Lemuria. And from what I'm getting is that we can only perceive what we believe, and we can only perceive at the level of density that we are. So the reason why a lot of this knowledge of Atlantis and a lot of this knowledge from past civilizations is coming up to the surface, is it because these civilizations are still there, just operating at a different density, and now we are sort of vibrationally aligning with them? How do you see that process?
Yes, and they always have existed there. It's just as you would think of the seat of civilization, the country Egypt, continually excavating and finding new pyramids, new things of civilization that existed 12,000 years ago. And imagine, as there is this continuation of awareness within each and every one of you, to your point of the ability to know and then see. There's only been this limitation up until now of beliefs that you can or cannot know. And the truth is this evolving awareness is, there is, as one remains curious, always more to know. And through that discovery, expanded awareness, consciousness, experience of the planet. And innovatively, there will always be innovation, particularly now in the fifth dimensionary energy. If you look as close as 200 years past, look how much has changed in the world, and particularly in the last 100 years. Innovatively, what has happened is you're all connected informationally, globally, and that only happened a very few years ago, didn't it? But look how much awareness it has created.
As humanity ascends in their awareness and consciousness, what new innovations and technologies do you foresee us developing in order to expand even more in our consciousness?
It's developing as we speak. daily new innovations are coming. How to assist the planet, how to use new energy forms, new innovations in business. The old dense structures are not working. In this time, what you will see is a global economic structure that works for the entire world, not the few. There is that which would be the United Nations. It will be similar, but much more powerful and collaborative than it's ever been, because you're a collaborative species. And in this collaboration, you're better together than you are apart. Yes, there will be countries, but not at odds with each other, because you have the same purpose, not to rule the world, but to expand the world in awareness, innovation, and maintaining the sustainability of the planet itself and life itself. So this is where you are going, in a structure that serves all human species, it will serve all species on the planet. And that's what's evolving out of this chaos.
And how do you see this energy of war that we're seeing and all the suffering that it's been created? How do you see that moving forward? As will humanity ever get to a point that war is no longer an option and we can root ourselves in unconditional love? But what has been the purpose of war up to this point?
It's been control, hasn't it? Those few wishing to control the masses. And so what is happening, as each and every one of you recognizes how powerful you are, coming together in that form of knowing, not relinquishing your power to others, but the voice of the people. Political structures will change from this. They've already begun changing by the demands of the people. And that's what innovation and connection through your internet has given you. It will continue to show those who wish to control and truth, even though there's been a manipulation of that, each and every one of you knows the truth in you. Your receiver, your physical body, gives you a visceral experience when truth is told to you or spoken by you. You feel it in your energy system. And so pay attention to that. Critical thinking, asking what's true. If you're told something, don't take an opinion of another over your own divine knowing. Yes? And you will find in this, you're more collaborative in your thought. What happens when there's a cataclysm in the world, such as the wars you're witnessing? The first inclination from the majority of humans is, what can I do to assist my brothers and sisters that are in harm's way, that are in pain? That's the first human inclination, soul inclination, and that's becoming stronger. And what's important is to understand you all can do something. And what that is do the integrative process inside. And when you love yourself inwardly, that will radiate out into the world to others. Because what is happening is only a reflection on the inside when you are giving your power away to others. Yes?
What are the laws that rule this universe? Are there any building blocks or laws that we should know about? You talk about the law of attraction, law of receptivity. What are some of these laws that we can begin to understand in order to create the life that we really desire?
If you understand those, you're empowered. For there's the law of electricity. So electricity exists far before and always has existed, but innovatively someone came along to know how to harness it, to use that energy on human behalf. Yes? And it works the same way all over the world, doesn't it? The only time you think it's not working is if the circuit's been interrupted. Yes? Your lights don't come on. Something's happened. Then you seek for the disconnect. Well, it's true with the law of manifestation. Where's the disconnect? Often the disconnect is in one's own individual belief that they deserve to have the life they want to live. The quantum field, the energetic field of the universe, doesn't discern if what you're asking is good or bad. It just brings you whatever you think most about. Yes? And worrying is praying for what you don't want.
If you had the opportunity to be in a physical human body for one day, what would you do?
We are fortunate in having that opportunity on a daily basis. So we have the experience of knowing the finite texture of a human existence, which is excellent. So we see your world through your eyes.
What do you love about being a human?
Look at your planet. You can look at the beauty. You can experience the texture of it. Energy is constant. The form that changes, and the form on the earth is your human body that has the sensory perceptivity to experience food and taste and music, hearing, the earth, smell. Whether you enjoy the smell or not, you have the ability to have it. These sensory perceptivities are magnificent.
And why do you feel tasked to assist humanity specifically at this time?
For this shift of consciousness, as educators, we're here to teach. And this planet is in a transformation that it's never been in before until now.
And why did it take us so long to get to this point to have a shift? Does this have to do with a planetary movement? Does this have to do with something that we can't comprehend? Or is it simply just the timing of the evolution of humanity?
It's evolution. But it sped up.
It sped up.
Yes. In the sense of energy. For when you talk of construct of time, there is none in our dimensional experience. The construct of time, such as clocks and calendars, is just a construct to manage your lives. In the past, before there was such a thing, there was just light and dark. Yes? But now the evolution of what has happened in the human experience, you can be awake 24 hours a day if you wish. And you have the innovations that you can continue to be productive. Is it healthy to do that? No. But you're looking at how to manage all those things in a physical existence.
So if we right now never created calendars, if we never created watches and clocks and the concept of a 24-hour day, what would life look like for us? You mentioned light and dark, but would our perception of reality change?
You would still be living in the cave. And in the fright, flight, fear of if I go out my cave door, the tiger will eat me. And so it would be a constant fear. This is the evolution of consciousness. creativity, innovation. That's what you're here to do, to use that energy of creativity.
Because the fourth dimension is time, isn't it?
It's a recognition of time.
And it's also spiritual awareness.
Yes. And part of that spiritual awareness is no time. For what you can find is, even science will speak to this, is that you can collapse time and space. A physicist would call that a tesseract.
And what would you call it?
We would call it that as well, because it's the common knowledge, but it's a collapse of time and space, and you're capable of it.
And when one collapses time and space, what happens afterwards?
So, for an example, you are traveling somewhere. Let's say from Madrid, where you live, to Barcelona. And it takes a certain number of hours to travel there. Yes? But there are those who could collapse that space and time continuum and arrive there earlier, if one so intended.
Does this have to do with when yogis have learned or mastered the ability to bilocate and be at two different locations at once?
Yes, yogis do it, but so can you.
And how do we get to that point?
Use your meditations to refine your energy fields and become more aligned with the possibility. But in that, yogis, gurus have the ability to go into samadhi, which is manipulating the body, the vibrational frequency in the body. So it is held in place, you might even say paralyzed, as the energy of the yogi or guru or human or the soul leaves the body and appears in another place. So many people experience that, humans experience that when they have out-of-body experiences. They feel a sense of paralysis. And that's just the body protecting itself so it doesn't short circuit in the nervous system when the soul is going in and out.
Is this a similar experience as to what Sheila went through during her miraculous healing? Was this a spirit energy that healed, or what happened exactly to Sheila?
It was healing energy that went through the body to correct that imbalance that was there. Yes, that's what healing does. When someone says they're a healer, ultimately they're not. They're an energy sharer, balancing the energy of a physical body so that that individual, that soul in that body, is the healer. It allows for that which is imbalanced to become balanced with this energy input.
And how does it happen so fast in our perception?
It happens fast when it happens fast because there's a belief that it's possible and there's an allowance for it to occur. The only reason that it doesn't is resistance. And resistance can be something from fear, something in the emotional body. Resistance can certainly be a lack of belief of possibility.
And resistance can also affect our relationships, our financial world. What else does it affect in our life when we are resistant to it?
Everything. For you make it unwelcome in your experience. And resistance can be these little aspects of yourself that hold the belief that you're not worthy of your achievement of a life well lived. So that is why we're repetitive in saying, as you love yourself enough, love these parts of self enough, letting them know they're worthy, bringing them forward into the present, not stuck in the past and the history of a challenge or experience. And then energetic can work through and for you in ease and grace.
So it's about switching our beliefs and allowing ourselves to be receptive to the world and ourselves in order to draw a reality or a creation that we've been desiring and get resistance out of the way.
Yes. Sounds simple. Words are simple. Yes. But we would tell you it can be simple.
And when you talked about drawing upon this healing energy, for example, someone that may not be feeling their 100% health right now or wellness, how does one draw upon healing energy in order to create these spontaneous, miraculous healings in our physical body? What does the process of that look like?
There are a few things. Go into the place of imbalance, discomfort, pain. There's always an emotional aspect to that. So where is it coming from? What is the belief? What's the emotion that's held in there? And become familiar with working with the limiting beliefs we talk about. And the limiting beliefs is a lack of love. When you love your body, it will respond in kind. We hear humans degrade the body continuously.
Why does that occur?
Outward influences and judgments, yes. Humans tend to believe another's opinion over their own. And often are taught to loving yourself is conceited, narcissistic, all of those personality disorders we spoke about, and it is not that at all. But that's been a human paradigm and belief that it's been passed along for centuries, the not good enough. It began with the belief that you're sinners. Yes, it's ridiculous. There's no sin, there's only opportunities of growth. And that's a man-made construct as well, yes, to demean each and every one of you, not to see the magnificent beings that you are.
And why do we compare ourselves to other humans then?
Comparing mind keeps you from moving forward. And the Dalai Lama said the thing that is the worst thing for humans is the comparing mind. Yes?
I have one last question for you, Theo. We call this the time capsule question, and we ask this to all of our guests, and we'll also ask Sheila. But I wanted to ask you, in a moment where we're looking at the future around 15 to 20 years ahead, and the younger generations are going to be stepping into leadership positions all around the world, if you had the opportunity to leave a time capsule, a physical time capsule that you can fit anything that you wanted in there for the next generation of humans to open and use whatever you put in this time capsule to lead and to carry humanity out into this new world that we are co-creating as a collective, what would you include inside the time capsule?
Soul integrational process. For that is what will set you free, because the changes that you want to see in your world come from inside you, not outside. And if everyone in your world would do integrate and release the beliefs of not being lovable enough, not loving the self, and this has been around also taught, but the reason it has is it's because it's the truth. For you cannot love others unless you love yourself. There's always judgment and comparison. And you're each unique, magnificent humans. Souls having this human experience. And you each have in your voice a tone, a frequency that is unique only to you. No one else has it. Your soul note. That's your creativity as well. So sing your song.
Wow. Can our soul note ever change throughout life?
No. It is a constant, like the vibrational frequency of your soul.
It's our signature.
Yes.
I appreciate you so much with an open heart. Thank you for dropping the wisdom, as we referred to it. And I would love to continue our conversation, Theo.
We are appreciative of the opportunity to be of service unto you. And in the asking, it is given. We are complete for this moment. God's love unto you. Good day.
Good day. Thank you.
Hi there.
Welcome back.
Thank you. Thanks.
How did that feel?
It always feels good. You know, when I invite them in, I ask them to balance my energy. So physically, I feel really good. But I just have so much trust and love for the energy of Theo and how it's changed my life and how it's changed my thinking. And I'm just having much gratitude. Much gratitude.
Yeah. And how exactly would you say that it's changed your life?
Well, I've been a student of Theo now for 5 decades, and I have to tell you, everything that they told me from the beginning till now that would be happening on our planet, that would be happening to us as individuals and how they teach, I've applied in my life, which is, I have a great life. I love my life. I love the people I get to work with, like yourself. This is, you know, it's just such a joy to be able to share this information and to have it in my own life and apply it. So it's changed my life immensely. And as you spoke of, you know, the many years ago that I started doing this, it changed the entire trajectory of my life in many ways as to what I would be doing as my job. I can't imagine doing anything else. So yeah. It's, you know, it's enriched my life immensely.
And this is just coming from straight up soul recognition to you, is that not only has this work changed your life, but also you opened up a path for people to start doing what you're doing in their own way and bring through wisdom and information that I believe is activating so many people in the world right now. And I think it's truths and wisdom like these that are going to allow humanity to make that leap in their consciousness and ascend to the next level. And I would love, because I'm seeing around me, right? I'm seeing my generation. I'm seeing a lot of people get activated sort of in the same spontaneous way that you did so many years ago. Mm-hmm. And I would love to sort of have a quick masterclass from you of what becoming a channel or transmedium requires in many ways. I mean, you've activated some of the world's most renowned channelers like Abraham Hicks, Esther mm-hmm. Hicks. So if we were to have like a mentorship session, let's say, for the next generation of psychics, where would you start for them?
Just accept that you're more than your physical body, first and foremost. And that, yes, this is a natural birthright that you all have to be connected to source. To, you know, the angels are just, and spirit is just there waiting for you to ask for their assistance. And the fact that I could do this means that you can too. And maybe not in the form that I do it, maybe not in direct voice, but you all have your own unique way of information coming to you and through you and for you. And just making it welcome and knowing that you're worthy of it. I think the feeling of who me, why me? What did I do that's so good? Well, you did everything good. Because this is who you are to be. And thank you for saying that. I really appreciate having, you know, a little influence on these others who are making a big influence on our consciousness shift that's happening now. I love that. And actually, we do programs in the THEO group, mentoring programs, that assists people to hone their skills, if you will, even to know what is their best way of receiving, because we all are unique in the way we receive information. And we do a psychic and spiritual exploration class about that, that empowers people who are opening up, because people are to open up. That's the whole thing. It's not just a few of us, all of us.
If it's all almost of us, like inevitable at this
yes,
point.
Yes, yes. And so it's, I think it's very exciting what we're experiencing. I know all the devastation, all the chaos that we're seeing is heart-wrenching. However, it does have purpose to make the changes we're talking about. And those changes are in us to stand up and own the powerful beings that we are and say, no, we're not doing this way anymore. No, because that's the way the political changes happen in the world as well. As we see people stepping up and saying, no, we're not going to put up with this. And I find that really exciting, even, you know, it in some horrific ways, as we're seeing with these wars. We're awake now and more awake as we go along. And I have real enthusiasm for all the new generations coming because they're coming here on purpose. They're coming here to be purposefully in bodies to create this new world we're talking about. It's exciting.
Yeah. You call it the BS barometer.
Yes.
And I feel that the younger people have that their BS barometer highly online because we're looking at the world, we're looking at these wars and we're going, what's the necessity? Like, why are we doing this? And a lot of it is stemming from hundreds and hundreds of years back of disagreements and whose land was this and what boundaries did we put around our area? And like, in many ways, our generation is like, hey, let's wipe that clean. Let's start from new because we are connected. We are all one and we are one humanity. So why can't we move on from that mindset?
Well, you know, the pandemic showed us that, right? It didn't care whether we were in the United States or Europe or Australia, wherever we were in the world, the pandemic came there to show us we are one. And all this virus wanted was a host. Hello, we're the host. It didn't care what color your skin, what language you spoke, where you lived. It proved to us the oneness, right? As a physical oneness, but it proved also that we're better together than we are apart in the sense of evaluating, healing, bringing forth. THEO says in this time, the sciences and the arts will bring us together, not politics. And that's because we'll demand it. Well, number one, science has to bring us together for health and innovation. And the arts are necessary. You know, look what music does, for an example. Music, all kinds of music throughout the world, people gravitate to. And that, you know, all of the arts are important in that. And that's us. That's our creativity individually. And what we're doing is bringing forth those new innovations. I'm excited about where we're going. It's just bumpy and messy to get there.
Yeah. And you've also brought through grandchildren as well, right? Yes. Of what ages are they?
Oh, gosh. I have nine. Six boys and three girls, and they range in age from 33 years old to 11. The youngest one's 11. And we have one daughter that's not married yet, so more to come maybe.
Yeah. And what are you seeing from these younger generations?
Oh, gosh. They're all terrific. And they're all really bright, and they're much like you, Emilio. They want an expanded future, and several of them are young adults in the world, bringing forth their genius, and it's just inspiring to see. But they're not following the footsteps of these old ways of thinking, just like you aren't. You know, to have this program that you have says a lot to your generation. I mean, you're curious, you're interested, you're experiencing your own soul, your own unique abilities, and that's what they're doing. And it's really fun to watch that. It's affirming what Theo's talked about over these decades.
Yeah. And does the psychic powers run in the family?
Yes. And it runs in my human family. So, my human family, it runs in. And we're going to see more and more of that as well.
Beautiful. Sheila, I would love to begin to wrap up this beautiful conversation with some final questions. We call this the final trio. But before that, you've mentioned some of the programs, some of the work that you put out. Where can people connect with you if they want to dive deeper into your work, which I know they will?
The best place is our website, and it's called asktheo.com. And you can just go into events, you can go into programs, and you can see all the mentoring programs that we have, which are several. And then we have a membership that if you belong, we do a webinar once a month for all the members, and people can ask their questions to Theo. Yes.
And I got the opportunity to read a large part of the latest book, The Art of Relationships, which is your partner Marcus asking Theo questions about human relationships and about end of life and about betrayal and about so many different nuances of the human experience. And I really recommend people to go to that because there are some great tips, the great wisdom that people can get from those.
And we've already revised it, which a new revision will come out. It's really good in its form, but we've made it a whole program. We have videos. We have meditations that we created with Barry Goldstein. If you're unfamiliar with him,
I love Barry Goldstein.
So I
love him.
He worked with Theo. So we have several new meditations. We have 12 that go along with the book, each chapter, but we have three others that individually are 30 minutes long with Barry's music. So we have a lot coming out in the first quarter of 24. But we have a lot going on that people can participate in. They can stick the toe in or they can jump in the pond. which, you know, we have all different levels of activities. So I would encourage, if you're interested or curious, come check it out on the website.
Amazing. Thank you for that. And for the final trio, the first one that I have for you is, what's your daily practice to integrate your soul into your life?
Before I even put my foot on the floor, when I get up in the morning, I do a gratitude meditation. And I give gratitude for one thing, large or small. And I tell myself one thing I'm proud of myself for. And then I start my day. Because we usually start with all the things we haven't accomplished. So
yeah,
starting with gratitude, that's a practice. Meditation daily is a practice as well. A few minutes every day.
Yeah, and we tend to seek out so much recognition outside of us. And, you know, even like when someone in our job, our boss or our parents tell us we're proud of you, it's like the best feeling in the world. But then if we accustom ourselves to get that from the outside, then we'll feel empty on the inside. So why not tell ourselves that we're proud of ourselves first, and then the outer world will reflect that? So I love that practice.
I agree with you. And Marcus and I have flip that. Instead of saying I'm proud of you, as you should be proud of you.
Yes,
you should be. You know, the I'm proud of you, of course, is part of that. But if you say to somebody, you should be proud of yourself for that, it, you know, it makes you sit up straighter. It's kind of nice, right?
Yeah. The second one I have for you is, if you were to ask THEO any pressing question that you have right now, what would that be?
The same thing I ask them every day. I ask them to assist me this day in all things large and small, and I'm open and receptive for that assistance now.
And what's the largest thing that they've assisted you with in your life?
Oh, everything. I mean, they told me I would write a book, and I'm, you know, before my first book was written, and I was like flabbergasted. I was like, what? And that was a huge assistance. But probably meeting my husband. Yeah. He read my first book, and that's how we met. He wanted to meet me after he read it. So, as you know, you read the story. But that was...
Yes.
I always knew I would have a partner, a male partner to do this work with. And he showed up.
Oh, yeah. Beautiful. Beautiful. Yes, that's in the book, definitely, The Art of Relationships. Mm-hmm. And the final question, we asked this at the end of every show. I don't know if you remember, we asked THEO this, the time capsule question. Do you remember it?
Yeah, it's kind of fuzzy. So ask it.
Okay, we'll repeat it. So we call this the time capsule question. It requires us to travel out a bit into the future, 15 to 20 years down the line. And in that moment, the younger generations, the children of now, of today, are going to be stepping into leadership positions all around the world. And they're going to want some assistance. They're going to want some guidance for how they're going to lead into this new earth and really potentialize the collective consciousness that we're building. And if you were given a time capsule and you had the opportunity to put in anything, it doesn't have to be physical, into that time capsule beyond your imagination, what would you include in that time capsule for these next generation of leaders to open and to receive the gifts so that they can lead better and be better versions of themselves and humanity?
The first word that comes to mind is wisdom. And I would encourage them to pay attention to their own inner wisdom, their first impressions, the first knowledge that they have, what some might call gut feeling, follow that, pay attention to it.
Inner wisdom. I love that. Yes. Sheila, thank you so much. This has been such a pleasure, and all the synchronicities that really led us up to here. I feel that we both had agreed to get on this call beforehand, before we even knew intellectually that we were going to be here creating this epic conversation. So I just wanted to thank you from the heart. You're doing amazing, incredible work. And I would love to have you back on anytime and continue our conversations.
Oh, I've loved our conversation too, Emilio. And you know, let's keep it going. I would love to have another conversation with you. It's been a delight. And I'll look forward to the next time.
Yes. Thank you, Sheila. Appreciate you.
You're welcome.
Much love.